counseling. Some idea? What counseling is? Vaguely some idea? What counseling is? When you understood the overview of counseling, what do you think is a dominant thing in counseling when somebody comes to you? Listening to what? What do we listen to? To their feelings. Right? We said that we have to listen to their feelings or we have to listen to their emotions. Right? Emotions and feelings are used interchangeably. But when we say feelings, and we said that anybody who comes to you, if they can deal with their emotions, they can deal with the rest of their life. Is that true?
Yeah.
Right? Morning to evening, when you look at today's, let's say today morning you got up and you started coming, preparing to come here. How many emotions would you have gone through? How many emotions would you have gone through? Can you list some of the emotions you would have gone through since morning today? Give me one emotion you have gone through in the morning.
Excitement.
Excitement of coming to a new course. What emotion would you have gone through?
A sense of urgency.
Sense of urgency to get here in time.
Yeah.
To get here in time. Sujata? What am I going into? A sense of anxiety?
Yeah.
Sense of anxiety?
Excited.
Excitement?
Excited.
Excitement? Vidya?
What will be there? Who will be there?
Curiosity?
Curiosity.
Curiosity.
I was happy that I was coming here.
You were happy that you were going to come for the course?
Yeah.
Happiness?
Yes, happiness. Yeah. At the same time, I didn't know to get here.
Anxiety was there. How do I get to this place?
Because the route and the timing in Bangalore.
Yeah. Yeah. Can I reach on time?
Yeah.
That kind of thing. It's anxiety. Yeah. Shanta.
Curiosity.
Curiosity. Right. So look at the words. Look at the words. Curiosity, anxiety, happiness, right? Excitement. Now, all these emotions, right? This is what dominates our life. If you look at every day of your life, emotions just dominate your life. Right? The head is full of emotions in a sense. Right? So unless we learn to manage, to understand the emotions first and then learn how do you manage these emotions. Right? Are there methods to manage these emotions? Tomorrow somebody comes to you for counseling. So how do I help them to deal with their emotions? If I can help them to deal with their emotions, they can deal with their situations. Often I can't do much about the situation of the person. Right? I can do nothing about the situation of the person. I can only help them to cope with their emotions. Do problems have solutions? Do all problems people face have solutions? What do you think?
No.
All problems have solutions.
No.
Right? There are problems which are there without solutions. There are no solutions to these problems. Give an example. What would be a problem with no solutions?
Loss of somebody
to death. Let us say somebody comes in to you and says, my grandmother passed away. Like she was the one who brought me up very much close. I was very attached to her. She was very pampering to me in my childhood and she has taken care of so many things for me. And she passed away. I feel miserable about it. I feel very sad about it. I feel very devastated by her death. Is there a solution to that? Can I say, okay, take my grandmother and make her your grandmother, or let's go to the old age home, pick one grandmother and make her into your grandmother. But all this, there are no solutions to this. Right? This person has to only learn to cope. Right? There is no resolution for the problem. She has to cope with her emotions. Emotions of sadness, emotions of frustration, emotions of, you know, anger at loss. Right? When somebody dies, the emotion is not only sadness. Can we feel angry when somebody dies? Right? People can feel very angry with themselves, with a person who has passed away. They can feel angry with the God for having taken away somebody close to them. They can feel anxiety. Right? What will happen to me? Right? Suppose somebody, you are dependent on passes away, now what happens to me? Right? So there can be a sense of anxiety, there can be a sense of sadness, there can be a sense of frustration, there can be a sense of anger. So all these are emotions. So when we understand that these are the things that are emotions, how do we define an emotion? What's an emotion?
Emotion is a mental condition in response to a certain situation.
It's a mental condition in response to a situation. Any other things that you can think of? What would be an emotion? It's the activity of the hormones in the body. That's a very scientific way of putting it across. It's the activity of the neurons in the brains. Right? What is an emotion?
Reactions.
Reactions to?
Situation.
Reaction to situation. Well, when we say reacting to situation, like he said and Shweta mentioned, can we just not have anything happening outside and still have an emotion?
Yeah.
Nothing is happening outside. I'm not reacting to something happening outside. I'm just sitting by myself.
Yes.
Can I still feel an emotion? Because I can recollect something from my own past.
Yes.
Or I can look into the future and say, what's going to happen tomorrow? Like tomorrow my results are gone for a medical examination, I have not yet got the report. Tomorrow I am going to get a report, what's going to happen to them? Nothing is happening right now in front of my eyes. It's going on in my mind. So, one is a reaction to an external situation. Another thing, it's also a reaction to your own thinking. So, a reaction to your own thinking, right? So, when we look at the contents of our mind, what happens in our mind, there are two things that happen in our mind, thinking and feeling. Thinking plus feeling. Thinking plus feeling. This is what happens in our mind. Right? When we say the contents of our consciousness, when we say we are conscious, when we are conscious, what's happening in our mind? Lots of thoughts and lots of feelings. Thoughts all of us can understand. Is that right? We can easily understand what thinking is. Let me just do an exercise of that also. Just tell me what you are thinking right now.
I don't think particular.
What's the thought? What's the thought in your mind now?
Please, a few months ago I had heard something about mind. So,
okay.
I was just...
You were thinking of that.
Yeah.
Right, Sujata, what are you thinking right now?
Nothing.
You are thinking nothing.
Thinking, what is thinking and what is feeling?
What is thinking and what is feeling?
What is thinking and
what? That's what you are thinking of.
Thinking and feeling will lead to some kind of
behavior.
How should I answer?
That's what you are thinking. Okay, see, that's what I wanted to understand, that there is something, thinking is different, feeling is different. Do we all understand that? That there is something like a thinking and there is something like a feeling. That thinking is about a particular thing, you are just going on thinking. Then when we come to feeling, feeling is a bodily sensation that occurs inside us, and a feeling is a spontaneous thing. All of our feelings are spontaneous. It spontaneously arises from within us, right? We have no control over our feelings. How many of us believe that we can control our feelings? Can we really control our feelings? Do you control your feelings or or do you control your behavior?
Behavior.
Right? So, we have three things. Thoughts, feelings and behavior. Thoughts and feelings together lead to a behavior, like one of you said. Thoughts and feelings together lead to a behavior of us. You are standing in a queue. Somebody just comes and nudges you. Right? Just pushes you like that. You get angry and you just turn around. That angry, getting angry is not in your control. Right? Somebody pushes you, you are going to get angry. Right? You turn to look around, you see a small child. What happens to that animal? It just dissipates. Oh, he pushed it by mistake. Or you see a friend and you say, oh, you. And you become to laugh when somebody has pushed you. You see a stranger, you want to ask what, can't stand, can't keep a distance or what. Right? So what happens? The behavior of what you do, that can be in your control. But the feeling of anger is not in your control. None of the emotional feelings are in our control. That is something we need to understand. Often people think that, why don't you control your emotions? We can't control emotions. Because emotions are spontaneous. And as a human being, you have every right to every emotion. If you are getting angry, if you are getting sad, if you are getting anxious, if you are getting frustrated, if you are feeling guilty, it is your right to feel all these things. Because you are a human being, you will feel all these things. Right? It's a right to feel every emotion that comes to you. And you don't even have control over the emotions. You have no control over your emotions. Right? We don't consciously think those thoughts. Sometimes when you are focused on something, you are thinking of those thoughts. Otherwise, thoughts are like monkeys, no? They just jump from one to another. If you look at your own thoughts, for 2 minutes you are thinking of one thing. It jumps from that connection to another connection, that connection to another connection. By the time you come to the thing, you know, how did I start thinking about this? Where did the chain start? Right? You're not even aware of where the chain has started. Sometimes you try to trace back your thought. Where did this start? And you don't know where it started, where it ended. Right? So thoughts are like that. Even feelings are not in our control. Feelings are spontaneous. They just come and go as they like. And when we say feelings, normally we say feelings are momentary. Right? We say the feelings are momentary. They are there for a short period of time. Right? When we want to understand feelings, we need to understand that when feelings last for a longer period of time, what do we call it? You call it a mood. Feelings, then it becomes a mood. Right? I say, from today morning, I have been in a sad mood. What do we mean? We mean that the feeling of sadness has lasted for a long period of time. Right? If it is just a, like somebody pushed you in the queue, you're getting angry, you turn around, you see it is a child, that the anger is gone. So the anger came and it went. It was momentary, it was just a flash like that. Right? Suppose you something really has happened, you went to the office and the boss scolded you, and you're carrying that anger. How could he have told this to me? He was so unfair. I did the right thing. Instead of doing the right thing, instead of praising me, he has been calling me this thing that you are not competent, you didn't do it properly. It was so unfair. Yes, boiling. Even as you're driving back home, you carry the anger back home. So you're in an angry mood. A mood is something that lasts longer than a feeling. Right? If the mood lasts longer and becomes a part of your personality itself, then we call it a temperament. We call it a temperament. This person is short-tempered. We say somebody, we look at somebody and say he's a short-tempered person. What do we mean?
He gets angry
at everything, and he gets angry quickly. You know, very quickly he gets angry. For smallest thing, he gets angry, and smallest thing, his anger is at that level. So we look at this person and say, he's a permanently angry person. Right? She's a permanently sad person. She's always a sour person. We look at somebody and say, oh, she, forget about her, you can never cheer her up. She's always a sad person. Or we look at somebody, people, and say, she's always an anxiety person. No, always anxious, you know, what will happen if that completely looking into the future part of it. So it becomes a temperament. A temperament is a personality itself. The personality, because it's been constantly angry, constantly sad, constantly anxious, it has become a personality trait for this person to be like that. It is no longer a feeling. It is no longer a mood. It has become, the personality has become there. So we say that it has become a temperament. And if a temperament lasts for a longer period of time and they start hurting themselves or others around them, we say it has become a disorder. You say it has become a disorder. This person has got anger issues. He needs to go and get some psychiatric help. Or this person has become depressed. Sadness, constant sadness has led to depression. Right? And this person needs some psychiatric help of a medicine or something of that sort. Or this person has become so anxious all the time. They can't sleep. They can't eat. Right? So they become anxiety disorder has become. It has become a disorder. This person needs psychiatric help. Right? When we say psychiatry, we mean that he has to go to a doctor, an MBBS doctor, and take medicines from them, because that thing has no longer in his control. That's what we look at. So it's obvious that the feelings become moods, moods lead to temperament, and temperament becomes a disorder. Right? Now let's take a look at this. We always say that we have a feeling side and we have a rational side. Is that right? We say that people are emotional side and rational side. I wanted to distinguish between feelings and emotions. When we say a feeling, suppose I say this room is warm, I'm feeling very warm in this room. Is that a feeling? But is that an emotion?
It's a feeling.
It's a feeling. It's not an emotion. So all feelings need not be emotions. Right? I can feel hungry. Hunger is a feeling. I can feel the hunger in my body. But it's not an emotion. So for an emotion to be there, we have got to have some reaction in the mind. Right? All feelings are not emotions. Physical feelings are different from emotions. Physical feelings are hot, feeling cold, right? Feeling warm, feeling hungry, feeling sleepy, feeling tired. All these are physical sensations. So all physical sensations are not necessarily emotions. Right? All physical sensations are physical sensations. Whereas every emotion will have a physical sensation attached to it. When you get angry, does your body react? Right? When you get anxious, does your body react? You start sweating. Right? Your breath becomes shallow. Your breath becomes shorter. Right? Your heart beats faster. Right? Sometimes you can freeze in panic. Your body is reacting to an emotion. All emotions have a body component attached to it. But all body feelings are not emotions. That distinction that you need to understand. So coming back to this of feelings and the emotional side. Do we have an emotional side and do we have a rational side, all of us?
Yes.
Right? we have an emotional side and you also have a rational side. Now, sometimes people say that men are more rational than women, or they also say women are more emotional than men. Is that true? Is that true?
No,
I can ask one man who is.
But they know how to express ideas.
They
feel the same amount.
They feel the same, but they don't express. Right? This is the truth. Emotions, I want you to understand, emotions are common for all people, irrespective of their age, their culture, the country they come from, whatever beliefs that they have. Emotion is a common denominator for all people. Right? Men feel emotions, women feel emotions. How they express that emotion can differ because of cultural indoctrination. Right? Boys have been told you can't cry. Right? We saw that advertisement, isn't it? That bachche rote nahi hai. Right? So it goes on and on. You have been indoctrinated that you can't cry, which means you can't show your emotion. You can't be emotional like a girl. Right? So because we have been constantly told, we suppress our emotions and we feel like it is not right to express an emotion. But in cultures which allow everybody to express an emotion, men can be seen to be emotional, women can be seen to be emotional. There's nothing which says that women are more emotional than men. It's just that women tend to express their emotion more freely than men tend to express their emotion, but men and women are equally emotional. When we say emotions and feelings, do animals have emotions?
Elephants have.
Elephants have emotions. Elephants can become sad because they lose someone to death.
Yeah.
Right? Do animals become angry?
Yeah.
Do animals become sad?
Yeah.
Yeah. Do animals become anxious? You see that animal, that particular thing, it has lost its baby, just anxiously looking around where my child is gone. Right? So emotions are common to all living things. Right? Emotions are common to living things, only that as human beings, because our thoughts are mixed up with emotions, we have a greater degree of emotions. We have a wider range of emotions. Now there are, I think, nearly about 170 words to describe emotions, if you can look into that. Right? So many things are there. So there's nothing like we are only emotional or we are only rational. We are emotional and rational both. But which is dominating? To understand which is dominating, I just want to give you an analogy of how it works. Just imagine an elephant. An elephant is there and a man is sitting on top of an elephant. A small, tiny man sitting on front of a huge elephant. Who's physically more powerful?
Elephant.
Elephant is more physically powerful. But a small man sitting on an elephant with a small stick, he can make it go wherever he wants. He pokes it here, it goes this side. He pokes it here, it goes that side. He can make it sit, he can make it stand. Right? Under the normal circumstances, the man can control the elephant in all situations. But suppose one day the elephant decides that today it is my day. Does the man have any chance?
No.
Right? It just travels him and goes wherever it wants. Right? There's no way that man can control that elephant. In our mind, emotions are the elephants. Emotions are the biggest dominating thing in our head. The small rational side is sitting on top of it. Right? Guiding it to go normally for what is good for you. The rational side always comes and says, do this, it is good for you. Don't do this, it's not good for you. Emotions dominate. But normally the rational side helps us to go wherever you want. Today morning you got up and said, oh, this workshop is there. Why should I go? Right? Some of you have the feeling, oh, again, should I go for this workshop? Should I not go for the workshop? Then the rational side takes over. No, this could be very interesting. Why not go and check it out? Right? Why not go and check it out? Okay, let me go. Right? Tomorrow morning you wake up, again the feeling could come, then you say, no, I've already paid the fees. Right? I've already paid the fees, let me not miss this thing. And yesterday I met some good friends, maybe I'll go and enjoy it for one more day. Only 3 days will let me enjoy it. What's happening? The emotion is saying, don't go. The rational side is coming, go. Right? Or let us say, your mother-in-law or somebody tells you something. And you want to tell her back what you think. Right? You want to say, oh, this is what she said, I'll go and tell her this is what I should tell. Or your boss has said something, yeah, I'll just go tomorrow and blast the boss. Then the rational side will come and don't do that. If you do that, things can become more complicated. So the rational side is guiding you not to allow the emotions to dominate you all the time. Right? That is how the rational side and emotional side keep balancing each other. But the day the emotions take you over, there is no chance for the rational side. Right? And these moments when emotions dominate us, we call it an emotional hijack moment. We call these moments as emotions have hijacked us, which means we are in control of their emotions, emotions are not in our control anymore. Right? We have all experienced this emotional hijack moment, isn't it? When just anger has taken us over. When anger has taken us over, or when fear has taken us over, when anxiety has taken you over, there's no rationality, there's no logic operating behind that. And anybody comes and gives you logic, you don't want to listen to logic at that point of time. Right? Let us say your spouse has gone out, he said I'll be back at 8 o'clock, or your daughter has gone out, she said I'll be back at 8 o'clock. 8 o'clock, she doesn't come back. He or she doesn't come back. You start wondering what happened. They said, normally they always come at 8 o'clock, but they have not come at 8 o'clock. You call on the phone, there's no answer on the phone. Does your heart start beating? It will suddenly think, what's happened? 8 o'clock, normally they'll pick up my call every time I call. Today is not picking my call. Okay, maybe I'll call it 5-10 minutes later. You can't wait for 10 minutes, you call at the end of 5 minutes. Right? You go on calling for half an hour and there's no response. The phone is ringing, there's no response of any sort. Has the thing started taking over? Has the anxiety started taking over? When somebody, let us say there's somebody else in the home and you say, look, 8 o'clock, she has not come. You're pacing up and down the hall because it's your daughter and it's dark outside. She has not returned home and she's not picking up the call. You're walking up and down outside and somebody else is there at home. That's what happened. You say, no, my daughter has not come back. It's 8 o'clock, half an hour. I've been calling her. She's not answering on the phone. Why do you get so anxious? She'll anyway come. Don't want to listen to that. Right? I am feeling anxious. I will feel anxious. Let me feel anxious. Right? If I'm feeling angry, let me feel angry. That's the response you have, isn't it? You don't want to listen to logic, you don't want to listen to rationality, you don't want to listen to anything. Because you have had a moment of emotional hijack. So the emotions have been hijacked. You feel terribly sad if your pet dies or somebody you love dies. Somebody says, oh, why are you mourning so much? You know, everybody dies. I know everybody dies. Everybody knows everybody will die. But I don't want at that moment somebody to philosophize and tell me, oh, everybody will die. Life is like this, life and death are the same cycle. I don't want Bhagavad Gita when I'm feeling sad. Right? I don't want to hear moralizing from someone when I'm feeling sad. Right? That is what we call an emotional hijack moment. When emotions are get hijacked at a particular point of time, I don't want to listen to rationality at all. I can't listen to rationality. I said, don't talk to me like that. Right? I'm feeling anxious because she has not come. Are you not worried? You want everybody around us to be worried because something happened like that. Isn't it? So this is what I want you to understand, that when emotional hijack moment occurs, we don't want to listen to rationality. And in counseling, people come to you because their emotions have been hijacked. Right? They're coming to you because they're feeling extremely sad, they're feeling extremely lonely, they're feeling going through the emotions at the highest level, anxiety levels. Right? Anxiety levels are very high, so they're coming to you. They're feeling very angry with their sibling, with their parent, with their spouse, or whatever it is. That's why they're coming to you. So this emotional hijack moment comes in. And as a counselor, if I am sitting in front of them and I start rationalizing to them, it's not going to work. If I say, why do you get angry? This is common. If the children will be like this, you don't have to get angry. Or this happens in life. What do you expect? That you are something special, that it should not happen to you. People don't want to listen to that. Right? I don't want to hear moralizing. I don't want to hear philosophizing. I don't want to hear rationality from you. If I am coming to you with an emotional thing, I want you to support my emotions. I want to be heard out. I want somebody to listen to my emotions. That is what counseling is all about. Will somebody listen to my emotions? Right? Now, when we look at this part of emotional hijack and we look at emotions, there's one more thing that I would like you to understand, that there are what psychologists call as there's dominant emotions. Right? The dominant emotions of life, or which are what we call the gateway of emotions. Major class of emotions. But before I go there, like we said, emotions are there even for animals, right? And across cultures, emotions are there. There are 7 emotions which are recognized only by facial expressions. You look at the face, you can say, this person is going through this emotion. And this is common across all cultures. When they did a survey of all the countries, all the cultures, they came across 7 emotions which can be seen, in which all of us express our facial expressions in the same manner. Let me give you the list of 7 emotions. Can you guess the emotions?
Happiness.
Sad.
Right? Happiness is one emotion where everybody, every culture, people understand what is happiness. And there's a smile on the face, there's a grin on the face. This is happiness. Right? People understand happiness.
Anger.
We understand anger. Sadness. What is?
Fear.
Fear. We understand fear. What other emotion is something we can understand but only facial expression? No.
Annoyance.
Anxiety.
Anxiety and fear, I would put it in the same class.
Annoy or discussion.
Disgust, hatred.
Disgust. What's the emotion of disgust? What's the emotion of disgust?
Hate. Anger.
Disgust is something, when you look at something which you don't like. Right? You look at something which you just don't like, the emotion comes spontaneously out of disgust. Let's say your child doesn't like carrots. You have made a carrot curry for him. So you have to eat carrots. Carrot. No, what is that emotion? If the tongue comes out, either kind of a look. You look at the neck and say, this is disgust. So disgust is another emotion that's common across all cultures. Everybody expresses disgust in the same way of putting out the tongue. Putting out the tongue and like that. You know that thing of, suppose you go to toilet in a train or someplace and it's stinking. What's the reaction you have? That's disgust. That kind of a thing. I just don't like this. Right? Either you shrink your nose and put out your tongue, or sometimes you don't put out your tongue. Children often put out their tongue. Right? Adults may not put out their tongue, but that thing of the shriveling of the nose and I don't want to be here. That kind of thing. That's what we call it as disgust. Suppose you bring a gift to your child. What is the emotion that they may express? Surprise. Right? Surprise is another emotion that's commonly expressed with the eyebrows go up, the eyes become bigger, and the eyebrows go up. No, oh, I like this. That's a surprise. When you see something which you didn't expect, that's an emotion of surprise. This is another emotion that is easily recognizable by just facial expression. Right? There's one more expression apart from this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7th emotion which you can just make out only from facial expression, and this comes out, let me just see if you can guess this emotion. Not sure. Let's say you come to me saying that I want to be a counselor, and I'm saying, you want to be a counselor? I do that kind of thing.
Humiliation.
What's the thing for humiliation? What's the emotion for humiliation?
Insult.
You're coming close to that. When I look at somebody and say, this is lesser than me. You and do this.
Superiority.
The emotion of superiority. What is the emotion behind it? Contempt. We call it as?
Contempt.
Happiness, anger, sadness, fear, disgust, surprise, and contempt. These are the 7 expressions that are recognized worldwide by only facial expressions. You don't even have to tell anything. You just look at the face, you can say, this person is feeling happy, this person is feeling sad, anxiety. Anxiety and fear are same. Disgust, contempt, and surprise. 7 elements that are common to every culture, every country, every race, religion, whatever. These things are common. Out of these 7 expressions, 4 are considered as the core emotions. We call them as core emotions, or we call them as the gateway emotions. And these are the first 4. Happiness, anger, sadness, and fear. We call them as core emotions. Happiness is something we all understand. Right? Do we understand what's happening? Okay, give me some example of a happiness. What would be happiness?
Something that makes you smile.
You just see a friend out of the blue. Right? You feel happy. You just eat something good, you feel happy. Right? You kind of get a call from an unexpected person who has been very positive to you. You get happy. Right? You get a promotion, you get happy. Right? You can receive any good news, you feel happy. So happiness is a broad range of emotion. It's not just one emotion. It's a broad range of emotion. And in that broad range of emotion, sometimes we can be expressive, sometimes it need not be expressive. Is it possible? Is it possible that we are happy and others don't know it? What would be those kind of emotions? what would be those kind of emotions which can be seen or which can't be seen? Happiness, obviously, like suppose I'm smiling, you know that I'm happy. But can I be happy and you don't know it? What would I be feeling inside? What are the different emotions that I can feel inside, which are cousins of happiness, which are cousins of happiness, which you can't make out from just seeing my face?
Ice twinkle.
Ice twinkle, that's what I'm saying is, are there cousins to happiness? What are the other words you can associate with happiness?
Sometimes fear also gets associated, I think.
With happiness?
Yeah, I'm happy because I found something, I got something.
Yeah.
And then back of my mind, I have a fear that what if I lose this?
What if I lose this? No, I'm not talking about that. I'll talk about that in a while. What I'm saying is, what are the other words you can have synonymous with happiness?
Joy.
Joy is again something you can see. Right? So if you look at happiness, there is a way of that it is expressed or it is unexpressed in a sense. Right? Joy. Ecstasy,
satisfaction,
it can come or it can be within me, right? That's what we mean by it is an unexpressed emotion. Others can't see this, right? What about peace? Is peace also a happiness, right? Is contentment a happiness? Today I'm very contented, I'm very happy with what I have, but I'm not showing it in any way, there's no demonstration. What do we mean by that? This is demonstrable. This is not demonstrated, right? So there are two classes of any emotion that I can demonstrate this, I don't have to demonstrate this. So when you look at joy, when you look at ecstasy, when you look at pride, is pride a demonstrative thing? Like somebody comes and says, I won this thing, oh, I can feel very proud about it, right? We can see that pride is a demonstrable emotion, right? Something like satisfaction, something like contentment, something like peace, serenity, tranquility, right? All these are not emotions that are demonstrable. Right? If I can be feeling peaceful inside, I'm very happy. That is also happiness. That happiness does not mean that I've got to be smiling all the time. Right? It doesn't mean that I've got to be jumping with joy all the time. Right? So emotions can be demonstrable, emotions need not be demonstrated. So when we look at the demonstrated emotions, it is like joy, ecstasy, pride, is all something we can easily make out from somebody's face. But whereas satisfaction, contentment, peace, serenity, tranquility, all these are not emotions which we can see on somebody's face. So happiness is a broad range of emotions that comes from two things contribute to everybody's happiness. One is pleasures and one is purpose. Two things contribute to happiness. Pleasure and purpose contribute to happiness. What do we mean by pleasure and purpose? Pleasure is something very clear to all of us. Right? We all have experienced pleasure. Pleasure is eating an ice cream, talking to your friend, reading a book, all that is pleasures in our life. Just chatting with your own child, that's a pleasure. What is purpose? What does purpose mean? We say that two things contribute to happiness, pleasure and purpose. What does purpose mean?
We wanted to achieve something and we achieved that.
We wanted to achieve something, we achieved that. Anything else does purpose mean?
Quite a sense of accomplishment of we plan for something and we
achieve that goal. Goal achievement gives us a sense of purpose. Purpose also means something going beyond me. When you are doing counseling, and you help somebody else without any expectations of returns, that's what the helping hand volunteers do in the hospitals. They just help people. What do they get out of it? Right? But it adds a sense of purpose to your own life. Right? When we look at, I'm earning for my family, I'm doing all this work for my family, the job may not be pleasurable, but it gives you a sense of purpose. Purpose is something that goes beyond you. So in life, we need two things. We need pleasure and we need purpose, a sense of meaning. We say meaning to life. What's the meaning to life? I get the meaning from serving some part of the society. I get meaning from looking after my own family. Like if I was alone and looking after myself, it would be a different kind of a thing. That would give me the pleasures. If I get only the pleasures in life, I'm not going to be a very happy person. Right? I'm getting all the pleasures in life, but I don't have any purpose in my life. I don't have any meaning in my life. Sometimes we find people coming and telling us that in the counseling situation, that yeah, everything is there, but somehow I don't feel meaningful in my life. I'm not doing anything meaningful. There's no purpose in my life. I feel senseless. My life is whole senseless because I'm not contributing anything to the society. So purpose would mean you're contributing something to the society. Society can be just your family. Just your family and friends, or it can be something beyond that, like total strangers. I go and do a volunteering work there. What do you get out of it? I don't get anything out of it, but I like the idea of doing something to the society. I rescue animals. I look after old age people. I go and give company to old age people in the old age home. Or I look after some orphan children. I go and teach children in the orphanages. This is what gives you a sense of purpose. So pleasure and happiness is always contributed by pleasure and purpose. Right? Let's look at anger. All of us understand what's anger. Is there anybody who has never felt angry? Not possible. Right? So what does anger mean? When do we get angry? What makes you angry?
Sense of injustice.
Sense of injustice? What else will make you angry?
Expectation.
When the ego is hurt, it makes you feel angry. When expectations are not met, you feel angry. When else will you feel angry? When else will you feel angry?
If something which I don't like happens.
When something that you don't like happens, you can get angry. Yes. Anything else? What makes you angry?
Injustice.
Injustice makes you angry. Vidya, what makes you angry? Normally, what makes you angry?
Telling lies.
Telling lies. People coming and telling lies makes you angry. You telling lies makes you feel angry.
People coming.
When people come and tell you lies, it makes you feel angry because there is an expectation that we can't tell lies to some people. Right? We always say that within a family, you can't tell lies. Right? Within this close of husband, wife and children, you can't tell lies. Right? You got to tell the truth. Outside, you can go and lie if you want, but inside, at least you can't lie. That's what we tell our children. And when our children or somebody whom we love comes and tells us a lie, we feel like they are taking me for granted. Right? This is a violation of an ethics. So when we look at anger, we need to understand that there are two things that dominantly makes us feel angry. What are these two things? Take a look. Anger is caused by, like you people said, unmet needs. Unmet needs, unmet expectations, expectations not met, I can feel angry. Right? And then it also is caused by breach of boundaries. What does breach of boundaries mean? Why do breach of boundaries causes anger? Have you seen a dog getting angry? When does a dog get angry? When does a dog get angry?
If somebody comes into its territory,
another dog comes into its territory, right? Another unknown human being comes into its territory, it will feel angry. This is my area, this is my territory, right? No other dog can come into this area because this area is mine, right? We all mark boundaries like that. So each of the life forms has got its own boundaries. Like we all carry a bubble around us. I've got a physical bubble around me. I don't want this bubble to be violated. Anybody steps into things that belong to me, I get angry. This is my parking space. Right? This apartment has given me this parking space. This is my parking space. You cannot park here. I get angry because somebody is coming to my area. Right? This is my reserved seat. Right? This number is mine, this is my reserved seat. You cannot sit here, this is my seat. Right? So you get angry when somebody comes into your territory. You have given a room to your daughter or your son. Right? You have given said, from this day it is your room, you take care of this room. You suddenly walk into the room and one day and say, is this the way to keep the room? What are you going to get? Just get out of my room. Right? This is my room, I'll keep it the way I want. Right? Don't walk into my room and say how to keep it. I know how to keep it. Even if it is a mess, I know how to search in that mess. Right? You might think that how will you find something in this mess? I know how to search in that mess. So you don't tell me how to keep my room. So you just leave my room and go. Right? How many of us get angry when somebody looks into our messages? Do you get angry when somebody looks into your messages or somebody is watching the email when you are typing the email? What's happening? That's your space. Right? This is my area. Nobody can come into my area. This is my bubble. Right? So whether it is a physical territory like my physical space or my area, nobody can park in front of my space. Nobody can throw garbage in front of my house. Right? All these are physical areas. We all have this physical territory around us. Nobody can come into that. Right? Same way, we also carry an emotional bubble around us. This is my message. This is my phone. You want something from your purse? Ask me. Don't look into my purse. Right? We tell our own children that, isn't it? Don't look into my purse.
You want something, tell me. Not that I don't have any secret in my purse, but I don't want to touch it because it belongs to you. Right? We don't even want to allow our spouses or children to step into that area. Each of us as an individual has a boundary. Right? This is our area, nobody can step into it. And then we have something like a family boundary where the four of us are a family, outsiders can't come in here. Right? Within this, whatever it is, it belongs to all of us. These secrets are family secrets, it can't go out. That's why you get angry when somebody lies to you. Because as this is a family code. Right? This is a family code, this is a family ethics. So when we say breach of boundaries, we say that anything can be a boundary. It can be a physical boundary, it can be an emotional boundary. Right? These are emotional boundaries which should not be violated. Right? And expectations not met. Expectations not met, this is a huge thing. Right? All of us have relationships with other people. And there's always an expectation in every relationship. You have an expectation from your spouse, from your children, from your parents, from your siblings, from your friends. When those expectations are not met, we get angry about it. Right? People will tell you, have relationship without expectations. Right? You hear all those big people, the saints and the babas and all coming and telling you, have relationships, do not have expectations. You want to ask if you want to have a relationship without expectation, why have a relationship at all? Isn't it? So, every relationship comes built in with its expectations. If he is your spouse, you got expectation from your spouse. He is supposed to do these things because I am doing certain things for him. If this is my child, I am doing these things for my child. I have got expectations from my child. My dad has to do these things for me because he is my dad. Whether somebody else fulfills your expectations or not, that is a totally different thing. But having your expectations is a part of your life. You can't cut away expectations from a relationship. Every relationship will have its own expectations. And when those expectations are not met, you're going to get angry. Anger comes when needs are not met, when expectations are not met. Right? When we say needs and wants are two things. Needs are what we absolutely need. Right? Like air, water, this, food, all this are absolutely needed for us. Wants are things good to have. Right? That's how we distinguish between needs and wants. Needs are absolutely a must for a life. Wants are things good to have. Right? That's how we distinguish it. When our needs and wants are not met, we get angry. How many of us get angry when we are hungry? Right? We know, at least if we don't get angry, we know people who get angry when they are hungry. The moment food is there, I am expecting to go home and have food. If I go home and say, somebody says that food today, food is not done, we have to go outside, that's it. Right? The next half an hour, my mood is spoiled, I get angry. What is it? Not even food is there, the basic thing is not there. What is happening in this house? So, we have this expectations of the basic needs should be met. Right? If the basic needs are not met, we get angry. Right? That's what is anger all about. Anger always comes from unmet needs, unmet wants, unmet expectations and breach of boundaries. That's what causes anger. When we say breach of boundaries, is anger restricted only to our own unmet needs and our own unmet expectations? Or does it go beyond it?
We extend it to a close circle.
Right? First it becomes us. Then extend it to the close circle, right? My family is there, my family, nothing should happen to my family. If somebody violates my family's boundaries, I get upset about it. We even get angry when we lose a match.
Yeah.
Right? What is it about us?
It
extends to the country. Right? It starts with us. It starts with my expectations are this, so these expectations are not met, I'm going to get angry. My family is there, so these needs are not met, I'm going to get angry. And then it extends to the society and then it extends to the country. No, how can they lose a match like that? They just rolled over and allow us to walk all over the thing. Right? We won 7 matches, 8th match we could not win. Not even a close fight. So much of anger comes in now because something else is happening somewhere else. Nothing connected to you. Right? Or we get angry when we look at the recent incidents of child rape cases in Bangalore or Delhi. You know, imagine the Delhi rape case, it caused so much of Nirbhaya rape case, it caused so much of anger all over the country. What is it to you? Did your needs not get met? Did your expectations not get met? Did your boundaries get breached? We have something like a national ethics or national thing. This should not happen in our society. Right? When that happens, we get angry. So anger, any of these emotions, need not be restricted to only you. Right? It can go beyond. Right? We become happy when the nation wins. When some 12 people playing somewhere else win a match, we feel, oh, this is as if we have won the match. And as if we hit that sixer and we won the match. So it extends beyond us, not only to ourselves. That's what anger and happiness. Coming to sadness, what causes sadness? What do you think causes sadness? All of us have faced sadness. Right? When were you sad?
Unmet
expectations is a part of that. But what else causes sadness? Loss.
Loss.
Right? If there's one word that you can associate with sadness, it is loss. Any loss to us will make us feel sad. Like I can feel terribly sad when I lose something. As an example, I can say that I was going and I lost my purse. Can I feel sad? I lost some money. I can feel very sad. You go to a marriage and you lose a piece of jewelry. Can you feel sad?
Yes.
Right? I lost my car keys. Can I feel sad? Right? I can feel sad for losing anything material. Anything that belonged to me, it is no longer there with me. I can feel very sad. When your child walks back home from your school and is looking glum, you're sad, you can think you lost something today. Right? He's lost a pencil, he's lost a compass box, he's lost a book. So he's sadly coming to you and, you know, this child has lost something. That's how you identify sadness. Sadness is always caused by a loss. But loss does not have to be only physical. Emotional losses can also cause sadness. What would be an example of an emotional loss?
Another city, I feel sad.
Right? So when your child comes home with sadness, you ask him, what, looking so sad today? Lost something, no? No, I didn't lose something. Everything is there. Rubber is there, mender is there, compass is there. Then what happened? No, my friend said he will not be friends with me anymore.
Yeah.
I had a fight with my friend today and he said I will not speak to you for the rest of my life. Oh, my friend has lost him. The rest of my life is not going to speak to me. Right, so he's feeling sad. What is the loss? Loss is a relationship. Right? Relationship is a very intangible thing. We can't hold it in our hands. Right? So sadness can be caused by loss of something tangible. It can be caused by loss of intangible things which we can't hold in our hands. Right? He was a very close friend to me. I had a fight with him and somewhere that relationship is lost. Right? We feel sad even when we have a fight with our own people. Right? If I fight with my daughter and I feel, why did I fight with her? I feel a bit of sadness at the end of it. I should not have fought with her. The relationship is not completely lost, but there is a dent in the relationship. Right? Which means the relationship, somewhere we all of us have to feel the relationship should always be whole. Right? It should be complete. Somewhere if there is a dent in the relationship, I feel sadness about the whole thing because it is not complete. So any kind of a loss will make us feel sad. Loss of a relationship is sadness. And ultimate loss is losing someone to death. It can't ever come back. Right? If I lost my spouse, my dad, my mom, or my siblings, or my close friend, or my pet, I can feel extremely sad for having lost my pet. So anything that I lose will always cause sadness in me. Right? I can even lose an intangible thing like, suppose I was the president of my association for the last 12 years. Every year they elected me unanimously and I was the president of the association. This year they said, we don't want you to stand. And I'm feeling sad. What did I lose?
Loss of position.
Right? Loss of designation. Last year I was the vice president. This year they said you're going to be the general manager and not the vice president. So I got a demotion. Right? I lost prestige. I lost self-esteem. Loss of self-esteem can cause you sadness. Right? Loss of self-esteem. Like somebody said something to you and I didn't reply back to them. They walked all over me. Right? I can feel very sad. Why am I like this? Why did I behave so stupidly? No, my self-esteem is taken a loss. So any kind of a loss, it can be tangible, it can be intangible. Intangible things are like relationships, positions, designations, self-esteem, respect. Right? My child talked back to me today and I felt very disrespected and I felt very sad. What is this? Today's children, they're talking like this. Right? I can feel sad because of that. So any kind of a loss will cause sadness. And like we talked about anger, the loss need not be only mine. It can be bigger. My family lost something. My country lost something. I can feel sad about it. Right? Then let's look at the last one. Fear. Fear. What is fear? What do you think is fear?
When you experience some threat.
You experience some?
Threat.
Threat. Threat. Threat. Yeah. You experience some threat. What else is fear? What else would be
fear? Fear of causing damage.
Pardon?
Something has potential to cause damage
to you, then you can feel very fearful, right? Let me ask you this. Can you feel fearful about something that has happened in the past?
Yes.
are you looking into the future and saying, what if it happens again?
Yeah.
Right? Your experience of the past can drive you towards that. But something has already happened in the past. Can you look back and say, oh, I feel very afraid of that?
Yeah.
Is it possible?
Yeah.
Can you be afraid of something in the past, or is fear always about future?
It's a bit possible.
Give me an example. How is it possible about the past?
Something just happened, and I think the memories that the particular experience or incident leaves, it carries forth, right?
Yeah.
So I tend to extrapolate it into some other situation also.
Absolutely. So what are you looking at? Your experience from the past is already there with you. Let's say I took out my car to drive. First day I took out my car, I banged into two people. Right? Now I don't want to touch a car. Every time I look at a car, I'll think, oh, that day I banged into it. If I take my car out again, I might hurt somebody. So what is this, if I might take out again, is about? Is it about the past?
Future.
Fear is always about future. You can't be afraid of something that's already happened in the past. Your experience could drive you towards the fear. But it's already happened, you're not going to be afraid of it. You're going to be afraid of what if it happens again. So like he said, for fear to occur, there has got to be a what if thinking. All fear is, most of the time, is what if thinking. What if ... it goes on. Then endlessly the mind is swaying between the past, the present and the future. Most of the time you are never in the present. We are either in the past or we are in the future. Is that true?
Yeah.
Right? Most of the time our minds are either in the past, looking at what happened that day, why did she talk to me like that, why did my mom be so irritable, or why can't my dad be more friendly, or why is my sister like this? No, she told me that, she told me this, why is this happening? So always in the past, what if this happens tomorrow? What if I lose my job? Right? The company is laying off people. I heard that there's an economic recession or something. Company is laying off people. What if I lose my job? Right? What if I get old and there's nobody to take care of me? Right? You're already feeling that I'm alone, or I'm staying alone, or I'm single, or something, or that's what you're looking at. And you're saying, what if something happens to me and nobody is there to look after me? What if I lose all my money? What if this relationship breaks? What if my son turns out to be something different than what I'm expecting? What if my daughter runs away with somebody tomorrow? It's always a what if thinking that makes us feel fearful. So if there is one word you can associate with fear, it will be anxiety. Anxiety is thinking about the future with negative consequences. You're constantly thinking about the future, and it's always the negative consequences you're imagining. You're not imagining a positive consequence. Suppose you're imagining a positive consequence, would you feel anxious? Would you feel fearful? Would you feel fearful at all? If this happens, what's the big deal? I'll cope with it. Right? Let me just take that example of, suppose the company, you hear that there's a recession and the company could be laying off people. You start feeling anxiety, what if I lose my job? But suppose you have this feeling of, oh, if I lose my job, no problem, I've already put away enough money. Anyway, I wanted to take a break and chill for a couple of years and then think of what. Would I feel anxious? Would I feel threatened by the whole situation? Or suppose I also have this feeling that, oh, if I lose this job, no problem, my friend is there who is running a company. He's already promised me that you can always come and join my company, you'll get the same kind of salary. Would I feel anxious? What has happened? Because I feel like I'm not doing the what if thinking with a negative consequence. If this happens, I already have a solution for that. So fear is always caused by a threat in our environment. There's always got to be a threat. A threat in the environment plus inability to cope. Two things contribute to all fear. The first thing is that there's a threat in my environment. I might lose my job. That's a threat in my environment. And there's a feeling that I can't cope with this if this happens. Right? My relationship with my spouse is not working out. What if this breaks? If this breaks, I'm on the road. Suppose you have a feeling that if it breaks, I'm on the road. You feel that I can't cope with this if the situation comes up. If you ever had the feeling of this, there's a threat, this relationship could break, but I can manage it. Anyway, the relationship is not working out greatly. So if the relationship breaks, no big deal. Anyway, I've been earning, I've been putting away my money, I've been taking care of myself. Anyway, I've been alone in this relationship. What's the big deal if it breaks? Suppose you have that feeling, you would not be feeling fearful at all, because you feel that I can cope with the threat if the threat becomes a reality. Right? When we look at fear, I want you to understand that fear is not always about imagination. Right? Fear can be, the threat can be real or the threat can be imagined. The threat can be real, like the company is laying off a job, people's jobs, so the threat is real. I'm not imagining it in my head. Or suppose I went to the doctor and said, there seems to be a lump here in your hand, why don't you get it tested? The moment he said there's a lump in my hand, my anxiety levels are up. So I've gone for a test, results have not come. Can I feel fearful? Can I feel anxious that this is a threat now to my health? Right? So tomorrow I feel like, oh, this is nothing, this is always, I've had this many times in my life. And it has come and gone before also, it is always harmless tumor that has come and gone. One more tumor that has come and to me, anyway, I'll take a test. I've taken a test, I know that I'm used to this, I'm not going to feel anxious. But suppose I feel like, oh, three people in my family already have cancer. What is this? I've got a new lump here. He's saying just get it tested because other symptoms are also contributing to it. Then I'm starting to feel anxious because I don't know how to cope with this. So threat is always caused by two things. Fear is always caused by two things. Threat in the environment and the inability to cope. So when somebody comes to you for counseling, let's say anxiety is one of the things that people come to you for counseling. When they come to you for counseling, you're looking at two things. You're looking at examining the fear itself. How real is it? Because often what happens is, it is our imagination. Most of the time fear is in our imagination. What if I lose my job? Nothing is happening right now. But I'm thinking, what if I lose my job? What if this happens to me? What if that happens to me? I'm projecting my mind into the future all the time and saying, what if this happens? Then I'm going to be in trouble. Right? Most of the time, our imagination takes us over and it is not a real threat at all. So if you want to look at counseling perspective, we look at how real is the threat. We try to help the counselor to deal with the threat itself. How real is it of happening? Has it happened before in your life? If it happens, what are you going to do? Then we look at how can you cope with this? Let us suppose this really happens, you're going to lose your job. How are you going to cope with this? What is the thing that you're going to do? So we try to give them an action plan of saying how to come out of these things. That's how we deal with anxiety in counseling. So these are the three dominant emotions that come to you in counseling. Nobody comes to you for counseling because they're happy. And nobody comes to you, hey, look, I'm very happy, I want to talk to you. But that's not a counseling, they just come to share things with you. And they come to you for counseling because they're feeling angry, they're feeling sad, they're feeling fearful. Right? But when you want to understand emotions, do emotions come in a single thing at any time? Do you feel only fearful? If I lose something, do I feel only sad?
It can be
package. It's always a package. Right? If emotions come one at a time, perhaps we can even deal with it. Right? Emotions don't come one at a time. When you lose something, you can feel sad, you can also feel very angry. How stupid of me? Why did I do this? Right, you can also feel anxious. What am I going to do? I don't have the money now to get back home. What am I going to do about it? So emotions always come in a mixed up thing. Right? When you lose something, it can be sadness, it can be anger, it can be frustration, it can be so many things. It can be guilt at having lost something. Now somebody asked me for money, I didn't give it, now I've lost it. Right? I can be feeling guilty about it. So emotions always come mixed up. They don't come in a single thing. But there's always a dominant emotion at any point. We say that whenever you are sad, the dominant emotion is sadness, but it has got a lot of other emotions accompanying it. When you are feeling anxious, when you are feeling fearful, the dominant emotion is anxiety of what if thing. But you can also have sadness, you can also have anger, right? And when somebody violates your boundary, you can feel sad, right? How can people be like this? How can people walk into my room like this? You can feel sad. You can also feel angry. So emotions always come mixed up, and that really makes a mess of things in life. Because they don't come one at a time, if they come one at a time, I can deal with them. They come jumbled up. When they come jumbled up, it becomes even more difficult to deal with it. And that is the mess we have inside our head. And that is the mess we try to clear for people when they come for counseling. Right? We try to sort things out for them. What's the emotion that you are going through? This must be the emotion you are going through. Counseling is nothing but, you know, somebody comes to you with a tangled web inside their head. You know, all the colored threads are jumbled up. Green, red, yellow, everything is mixed up. When they come to you for counseling, as a counselor, our work is we separate the threads. This is green, this is red, this is blue, this is yellow. Now what do you want to do with it? So we put it across to them. That's what counseling is, helping them to deal with these emotions. That is the basic idea of counseling, that if somebody comes to you for counseling, can we help them to deal with their emotions? Right? Let me just take a quick look at what are the different ways in which we can deal with emotions. How do we manage our emotions? There are many techniques for managing our emotions. I'll just list out a few that can be implemented by most of us for managing our emotions, which psychologists have said helps people when they're going through a lot of difficulty, right? When you are managing emotions, one of the things, especially when it comes to anxiety part of it, is what we call thought shifting. Thought shifting is a technique for managing your anxieties. Right? What does thought shifting do? Like we mentioned earlier, our contents of consciousness is thoughts and feelings. Is that right? Thoughts leads to feelings. Feelings lead to behavior, right? We mentioned it like this. Thoughts lead to feelings and feelings lead to behavior. But if it was such a straight line, it would be very nice. If just thoughts lead to feelings and feelings lead to behavior, I exactly know what to do. Right? It's not so easy. No, it becomes like this. Now is this more messier? Where does it start? Here it was so beautiful, right? Thoughts lead to feelings, feelings lead to behavior. So if you want to change your feeling, change your thought. Now where does it start? Where does it end? Right? One thought leads to feelings, feelings lead to behavior, behavior leads to a thought. Right? Now even this looks easier. The real picture is not this. The real picture is this. Now look at the complications. It flows both ways. Right? Thoughts can lead to behavior, thought can lead to a feeling, feeling can lead to a behavior, feeling can lead to a thought, behavior leads to a thought, behavior leads to a feeling. Where does it start? Where does it end? So this is the real picture of the real thing that happens in our mind. The real jumbled up mess that is there. So when we want to look at thought shifting as a method, if we can kind of put it like, yeah, thoughts are leading to feelings, so how do we manage it? So if you want to change your feelings, you either change your thoughts or you change your behavior. Both are possible. Right? Both are an option if you want to. See, basically when somebody comes for counseling and we are dealing with emotions, we are trying to see how can you manage your emotions. I want to change the way I feel. Is that right? I don't want to feel this angry about this. I want to change the way I feel. Or I don't want to feel guilty about it. I've been feeling very guilty about it. I want to change the way I am feeling about my guilt. So if I want to change the feeling, I will change either my thought or I have to change my behavior. So this technique of thought shifting is, can you first become aware of your thoughts? Becoming aware of your thoughts is the first step to change. Any change starts with awareness. Am I even aware that I am having so many negative thoughts about my future? That I am constantly thinking about my future, I am an anxious person, am I aware of it? So we constantly say that, spend some time looking into your own thing. And pause for at any point of time in a day and ask yourself, what am I thinking and what am I feeling? The moment you stop at any point of time during the day and just pause and say, what am I thinking? What am I feeling? You become more aware of your thoughts. You become more aware of your feelings. Both you become aware. Right? When you become aware of your thoughts, you understand that I'm thinking a lot of things. I'm spending a lot of time thinking about my future and thinking in a what if scenario. I'm imagining a lot of fears. So that is the first step in awareness. Right? And then question the negative outcome of your thinking. I'm always telling myself that if I lose my job, what happens? If I lose my job, what happens? How true is it that I'm going to lose my job? How true is this? How true is that the company is going to throw me out? How true is it that I'm going to be on the roads? Do I not have an education? Do I not have a network of people? How true is it that I'm going to be on the roads if I lose my job? So you question the negative conclusions that you come to in your thinking. Then you try to replace it with positive thoughts or positive outcomes. What is the good thing that can happen if you lose your job? What can be the good thing that can happen to you?
Freedom.
One is freedom. What else? Can you get a better job?
Freedom.
Right? Perhaps you can get a better job. Perhaps you can get a better boss. Perhaps you can get a better salary. Right? Perhaps you can work in a new environment which is more conducive to your growth. Why do you always think that losing my job means everything is negative? So can I look at the positive outcomes of anything that is going to happen? Especially in a fearful scenario, when I am looking at an anxiety part of it, what is the positive outcome I can make? And then you make an action plan. Action plan is what? for the what if thinking that you are having, you are trying to say, what is the coping that I am going to do with this? If this happens, I am doing a what if thinking. What if I lose my job? If I lose my job, I am going to do these things. I am going to prepare my resume. I am going to upload my resume to all the job sites. I am going to tell all my friends that please look for a job for me. I'm going to post it here, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. So you have an action plan. When you have an action plan, you feel like you are more in control of yourself. Right? Anxiety comes in because we feel that I don't control the any part of my life. So you increase the control element on your life by bringing it into an action plan. Right? This is one technique for managing your emotions if your emotions are anxiety prone. You're anxious thinking, you're fearfully thinking all the time. Then you bring in the technique of thought shifting. The second technique that we can bring in is meditation. How many of you do meditation? 1, 2, 3, 4. What's the technique you use?
See, I don't really use any technique. For me, I can call it more as an introspection time.
Okay.
I just go over my you know, the thoughts and feelings, and I kind of try to, like what you said, that untangling part.
Untangling part.
To, you know, so that when I start the day, it gives me kind of a fresh start.
Gives you a fresh. You look into your own thoughts and feelings when you are meditating. How do you do meditation?
On the light.
On the light. You look at a lamp or a candle and you focus on that. Okay.
And see that everything inside is lit up.
Lit up.
So that there's no dark.
There's no darkness inside you. That's how you look at it. Good.
There are two things I do actually. One is the mudra thing. So I sit in a particular mudra and then breathe.
You focus on your breathing.
Yeah, breathing and the sensations in the body.
Sensations in the body.
While I breathe in the particular mudra. That is one. And then if I'm not doing mudra, then I pay attention to every part of my body.
Body scanning technique you do. You scan the entire body from top to toe.
Yeah.
Like you'll focus on from the head to the toe, you focus on each part of the body and you do that.
Right. And I command myself to relax my body.
Relax your body. So what is the essential thing behind any meditative technique? You can follow any technique. You can focus on your breathing, you can do your body scan, you can focus on the light, you can focus on a sound, right? You just close your eyes and listen to all the sounds that are coming into you. That's also meditation. Right? You just look at a point, you just chant one mantra or you chant one God's name or whatever it is you do. What is the essence of meditation?
Connecting with the breath.
Connecting with the breath?
Looking inside.
Looking inside.
Yeah, I would say that thoughts, controlling the thoughts.
Can I put it like this, that any form of meditation, whatever you do, the essence is to be here in the
present moment.
Absolutely here in the now. Right? There's no future, there's no past. I'm just here, I'm just looking at the light. I'm looking at the light and trying to just be focused on the light. I'm just focused on my breathing and or my body scan. I'm just trying to be here and now, not allowing me to go past. I'm just looking into my own thoughts. I'm looking into my own thoughts and feelings and observing my thoughts and feelings without judging them. Right? The entire essence of meditation is to be here in the now. If you look at most of the emotional thing that comes up, it's because, like I said, you're looking into the past, you're looking into the future. So the entire meditation is, can I be here for a few minutes in the present? That gives me the strength, or that gives me the calmness to deal with the rest of the day. It's an entire focus of meditation to be here in the now. Meditation has got nothing to do with religion. Right? If you are under the impression that meditation and religion are connected, meditation and religion are not connected at all. It's got nothing to do with it. It's just a technique to be here in the now. You can whichever technique you want. You focus on the light, focus on the sound, focus on your breath, focus on your body, focus on your thoughts that are coming to you without judging them. Even that is meditation. So we call another name for meditation, we also say it as mindfulness. Right? We say also mindfulness. Right? Some of you might say that I can't meditate because if I close my eyes, I go to sleep.
Yes.
Right? So who says that you have to close your eyes to meditate? You don't have to close your eyes. Anything that you do, if you can bring in your complete attention to what you are doing, that is mindfulness. Mindfulness is becoming aware of things as you are doing those things. Right? You're just going into the garden and watering the plants. You're just going there and watering the plants. Nothing else is there in your mind. You're just looking at the plants, you're feeling the leaves, that you're filling the can of jug in your hand, you're pouring the water, you're feeling the sensation of water flowing down from the can into the ground, you're hearing the sound of the water flowing down, you're smelling the earth as the water hits the earth and a new kind of a smell comes in. That is mindfulness. That is meditation. Meditation does not mean you have to close your mind, close your eyes and meditate. You can open your eyes and meditate. We call it mindfulness. Mindfulness can be brought into any activity of yours. Any activity of yours, as long as you're completely immersed in that activity, we call it as mindfulness. Right? So meditation does not have to be with religion, does not have to be spirituality, anything of that sort. Just focusing on whatever you do, that's one more technique to manage your emotions. The third technique that we can talk of for managing emotions is what we call as emotional writing. Emotional writing is another technique for managing your emotions. How many of you write a diary or a journal? Shweta, the two of you maintain. What do you write?
Whatever happened
the
whole day.
Okay.
I write.
You write whatever happened
in
the whole day.
What I feel, good, bad,
everything. Good, bad, everything. Okay. Do you write about your emotions?
Yeah, what I feel that moment.
What you feel at that moment. Yeah.
I used to write every day, but now it's reduced.
Reduced.
I write as in how there is an incident, or I want to talk about it or express a feeling.
You want to express your feeling at something that's majorly happened in a day, then you write. Yeah. See, emotional writing is not about maintaining a diary or saying today this happened, today that happened. That's you maintain a diary for a different reason. Emotional writing is when you're emotionally upset, you want to go and write at that point of time about your emotions. You have to write your feelings on paper. You go and put your feelings on paper. This happened today. This person talked to me like this. I felt very humiliated when she talked to me like this. I put that on paper. I express my emotions on paper. That is emotional writing. Right? It's not about writing about what happened today. Today I went to the workshop, attended a class on emotions. No. What did the class do to me? Right? When I was sitting in the class, I felt this emotion and I felt charged up about it. I feel now I can deal with this emotion in a better way. This is what occurred to me. That is emotional writing. Right? Emotional writing is always, why does emotional writing work to manage your emotions? Firstly, writing itself is a very rational thing to do. Two, our emotions here, when you look at the thoughts and feelings, are always jumbled up. When I have to write, I can't write a jumbled sentence. I have to write a proper sentence of, I felt very disappointed when my friend told me this. I have to frame a sentence. That brings the rational side of you into the picture. And you're also expressing, you're getting the emotions out of your mind. Right? So emotional writing is a huge coping mechanism for managing your emotions. Right? Then of course, the physical activity part. Any physical activity will help you to deal with your emotions. Like when you say physical activity, go for a walk, go for a jog. Right, do some kind of a physical activity, it's always going to help you to deal with your emotions, right? And the last one here we can mention is counseling. If all this fails, counseling is always a way to manage your emotions. What are you doing in counseling? You're going and telling somebody else what the emotions you're going through, instead of writing it on paper. You're going and telling somebody, look, this is what happened to me and I feel very upset when my friend told me this. I felt very cheated when she did this to me. She said she will come and meet me here. She didn't do this. She is taking me for granted. This is the second time she is taking me for granted. I felt so humiliated by this. You're going and expressing yourself out of it. So this is what we mean by managing your emotions. Right? These are the basic things about an emotion and how to manage these emotions. When we look at managing emotions, do you think we should manage our emotions all the time? Or only sometimes it needs some managing, other times it's okay to have the emotions. Is it okay to be angry?
Sometimes.
Is it okay to be angry?
Sometimes.
Yeah, it's okay to be sad?
Yeah.
It's okay to be anxious?
Yes.
Right? This is what I want you to understand. Each of the emotions, it's okay to be having all these emotions. As a human being, you should feel angry when somebody violates your boundary. Right? You should feel sad when you lose something. You should feel anxious when some threat is there in your environment. Right? You are sitting in the room and suddenly some knocking is coming somewhere. It's a dark thing. You are alone in the room. You will feel anxious. You've got to feel anxious. Because what each of these emotions is doing is it's giving you a message. Right? Fear is giving you a message that there's some threat in your environment. Please attend to it. Right? If you're not feeling fearful, you'll be taking unnecessary risks. Fear is a protective emotion. Anger protects your belongings. These things belong to me. Nobody can take away my food, my area, my belongings. Right? Anger helps you to protect your belongings. Sadness helps you to cope with the losses. Right? You cope, you grieve, and then you come out of the whole thing. So each of the emotions is good to have. There are no good and bad emotions. There are only good and bad outcomes. There are only good and bad behavior. I can get angry. What I do with my anger? If I am harming myself with my anger, I am hurting myself with my anger, or I am hurting others with my anger, then anger needs management. Otherwise, anger doesn't need management. If I am feeling constantly anxious, there is nothing happening, but every day I am feeling anxious, I need to work on my anxiety. How do we know when an emotion has gone to the end of where it needs management? You have to look at two things, intensity and frequency of an emotion. Intensity plus frequency. Am I feeling this emotion very intense every time? Every time I am getting angry, I am throwing things around me, I am destroying things around me, or I am shouting at people and telling them what I feel like doing with them. If that is the thing, it has become very intense. I need to look at getting help for that. Or it has become very frequent. Every day I am getting angry. No, morning for no reason I am getting angry, then there is something really bothering me. You need to work on that. Anxiety, anger, sadness. It's okay to be sad and you lose something. But suppose your sadness has become the mood, the temperament, it has gone. Then I need to work on that. If it is just a feeling, you don't need to work on any of the emotions. All emotions are okay to have. As a human being, it's your right to have all the emotions. Nothing wrong with any emotion. You need to work on the managing of the emotions only when it becomes intense or when it becomes very frequent. Right? This is clear about emotions, the basics of emotions and how to manage them. Any questions? Right now, I think one feeling that you have is of hunger. So I think we can go out and have our lunch. Right? We'll take a 45-minute break. We are meeting again at 1:15. Right? 1:15 we'll meet. 1:15 we'll be having a next session on rapport building, non-judgmental, two of the skills of counseling, and then 1.5 hours of practical work. We'll be doing counseling within the classroom. Right? You can join us for lunch in the first.